My topic has been made easier by the previous presentation by Dr. Schwartz, who has made an elaborate introduction about hypertension, its importance, what complications occur. And I will continue with the same, and my brief is on treatment, basically. So what's a rational approach to treatment? Because ultimately, you have to treat, you have diagnosed, but what do you do? We know that the prevalence is really very high. It's about 20% virtually all around the world. It's not just in Pakistan, it's 20% in the adult population, those above 18. So really speaking, it's a really high population. In those above 45, this goes to one third. In those in 65 and above females, it goes to two out of every three females. So it's really, really high. It's the most common chronic disease. And unfortunately, despite the fact that we seem to know everything about blood pressure, we still can't treat it adequately. And the control figures are really miserable, especially in our country. Despite the fact that some people are aware of it, despite the fact they have been diagnosed, despite the fact they have been given the treatment, it's still 3%. We know that it's a risk factor for multiple problems related to the heart, to the kidney, to the peripheral vascular system, and to the eye, and ultimately the brain. And you've seen this slide before, the global mortality of 2000, the impact of high blood pressure is the single most important risk factor for mortality. When you see a patient, unfortunately this slide doesn't project very well, you have to stratify the patient according to the cardiovascular risk. And you can see that despite the fact that the patient may have normal blood pressure on the high range, he can be at high risk, very high risk actually, or with high normals and with great. So it depends not just on the blood pressure, which is along this axis, but also on the other risk factors, and that's why it's called the global risk assessment of the patient. Whether he has one to two other risk factors, and we'll come to that, three or more risk factors, the evidence of target organ damage, the diabetes, or the evidence of established ischemic heart disease. What are the cardiovascular risk factors? Everybody knows about them. We have hypertension, cigarette smoking, obesity, physical inactivity, dyslipidemias, diabetes is a very major, it's a risk equivalent actually, microalbuminuria, age, and a family history of premature CVD. The target organ damage we've already discussed. So once you have the patient, it's not just enough to have the blood pressure reading, you have to have a history. You have to have the global risk assessment, and you start that by taking a good history. Prior history of kidney disorder, stroke, heart disease, diabetes, dyslipidemia, complications in pregnancy, especially eclampsia, drug history, family history, and smoking and dietary habits are all included in the history. And then you have to look for the signs, so you have to have a good examination also. And the signs may be in the brain, in the retina, in the heart, and in the peripheral arteries. So you have to look at all these factors to make your assessment complete. And then you even have to go to certain tests, because the signs may not be that obvious. So what tests would you be doing? You will be looking at the eyes with the fundoscope. You may have to do CT MRI of the brain. An ECG is an essential test. An echocardiogram is an optional, but often done. And you may even have to go for angiography. And then renal, microalbuminuria, biochemistry, and an ultrasound scan may all be essential. It all depends on your individual patient. The minimal investigation suggested by the Pakistan Hypertension League and the Pakistan Cardiac Society include a urine analysis for proteins, serum creatinine, serum potassium and sodium, random blood sugar, ECG, and a chest X-ray, secondary hypertension. Okay. Once you have made all this assessment, now, what is your goal of treatment? The main goal of treatment, according to the ESC and the ESH guidelines, is that the primary goal is to maximum reduction in total risk of cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. And this cardiovascular, of course, includes the cardiac, the peripheral arterial, and the cerebral vascular. And the NICE guidelines of 2011, basically says the same. The prime motivation for treatment in hypertension as asymptomatic condition is the prevention of mortality and morbidity. We have to reduce the cardiovascular mortality and morbidity and the renal morbidity also. So the target levels to achieve are a blood pressure of less than 140 by 90, except in those who have diabetes or chronic kidney disease where the level falls to less than 130 by 80. It is important that the blood pressure should be controlled over the whole 24-hour period. It's not just enough to control it in the morning or the evening. Okay? And drugs which exert their antihypertensive effect over 24 hours with a once-day administration should be preferred. Number one, they control it better. Number two, their compliance is better. The NICE guidelines also suggest that in all newly diagnosed hypertensives, you should have a 24-hour blood pressure monitoring done. And this is because it is economically worthwhile to find out whether this patient has white coat hypertension and is being unnecessarily treated, or masked hypertension and other complications. And a test done once may affect his whole life, because he may be wrongly diagnosed as a true hypertensive and be treated for many, many decades. So it's worth the cost. You've seen the treatment algorithm. The first step is always the lifestyle modifications. And if the goal is not achieved, then you go to the initial drug choices. And here, it's important to find what are the compelling indications, if there are any. And that will determine which drug you start with. The lifestyle modification is weight reduction, and this reduces blood pressure by between 5 to 20 millimeters, depending on what the initial weight was. DASH eating plan, which is a high fiber, high vegetable, fruits, nuts, and less animal fats, and avoiding dairy cream, can reduce by 8 to 14 millimeters, so a significantly worthwhile step to follow. Dietary sodium reduction, less effective, but advised. It's not an absolute salt-free diet, which you cannot achieve in any case, but you have to reduce it. Physical activity helps, and moderation of alcohol consumption. You've seen this one. This is the recommended NICE guidelines, which are the latest ones. The JNC haven't come for many, many years, and even the ESH is now 4 years old. So this is the one which is being followed. For those less than 55 years, step one is A. A means ACE inhibitors or ARBs, and they're equally good. Then for those age greater than 55 years, you have calcium channel blockers. And in step two, you can combine the two. And then in step three, you can add a diuretic. Now the concept of diuretic has changed, and this is important to know. Thiazide-like diuretics are being recommended, not thiazide diuretics. Now, this is an important differentiation. Multiple trials have shown that the thiazide-like diuretics, which include chlorthalidone and indapamide, are the ones which have the beneficial effect. And the thiazides actually end up causing more problems like diabetes mellitus. CCB is preferred, but consider thiazide-like diuretics in patients, people with edema or a high risk of heart failure. So now we come to individualization of the patient. These are just the very basic guidelines, but you have to individualize the patient when you start. Now, if the step three fails, then you go to resistant hypertension, and you can add anything that you think will work. Okay? There's no limitation here. But this is for those who do not have compelling indications. Just to stress on the two on the diuretics, there are two types of thiazide diuretics which coexist, the thiazide proper and the thiazide-like, which are indapamide and chlorthalidone, and the thiazide-like diuretics are the recommended. The new NICE guidelines state that the diuretic treatment is to be initiated or changed. Offer a thiazide-like diuretic such as indapamide or chlorthalidone in preference to a conventional thiazide diuretic. Now, Dr. Ashfaq also discussed about fixed-dose combination. Combinations are important, and the guideline is now to, in the mild hypertension, you start with a single drug, and we have discussed that. But whenever the blood pressure is greater than 20 by 10 above your target level, whichever was the target level, then you should start with a combination tablet, or in those in whom you achieve a quicker, want to achieve a quicker result, and especially those who have already got evidence of target organ damage. So this is important. The combinations which are available include the ACE inhibitors with hydrochlorothiazide or with indapamide, same with the ARB, the CCB with hydrochlorothiazide, ARB plus CCB, and the ACE plus CCB. The preference seems to be nowadays for the ARB plus CCB and the ACE plus CCB, which has shown the best results in the mega trials. When you are going to individualize, what are you going to see? Okay, you are going to see what the compelling indications are, and we have come to that again. And then special situations, which are all listed here. Now, these are the compelling indications. And what are the compelling indications? These include LBH, microalbuminuria, renal dysfunction, evidence of previous stroke, MI, angina, heart failure, the presence or recurrence of atrial fibrillation, end-stage renal disease, peripheral arterial disease, LV dysfunction, and various other conditions which are listed here. Just coming to this, if you have a patient with hypertension and heart failure, the choice would be a diuretic. And again, the things have changed here from thiazide. This is an old one from JNC, but now it's the thiazide-like diuretic. You can give a beta blocker because you now treat CHF with beta blockers. ACE inhibitors and ARBs are the choice drugs. And if you are still not achieving results, you add aldosterone antagonists, aldactone. Post-myocardial infarction, beta blocker is the first choice. You add an ACE inhibitor and you may need aldosterone antagonist. High CAD risk, again, the choices are similar. Beta blocker, ACE inhibitor, and a calcium channel blocker. So now you are seeing that depending on what the combination your patient has, and most hypertensives will have some other comorbid conditions, some other risk factors, and you are going to include that in your assessment of the patient and what drug to start with and then what drug to add on. Recurrent stroke is the thiazide-like diuretic and ACE inhibitor. That's the first choice. In renal disease, less than 35% acute rise in creatinine is acceptable on starting ACE inhibitor. Do not be afraid. Because in the end result, they will lower the creatinine, and especially if they do not lower even, they will stop the progression of the disease. So it's worth attempting to start, and do not be worried if the creatinine rises a little bit at the beginning. It often will, if it's already impaired. And if GFR is less than 30, replace thiazide with loop diuretic. The target, I've already told, diabetic nephropathy is the same. And non-diabetic renal disease is also the same virtually. There's no difference really. They're all helped. Renal disease, no matter what, is all helped. I think I'll stop here. The time is over. But just to summarize, you have to individualize your patient. You have to assess him correctly because this is a lifelong decision. Blood pressure is not going to go away in most patients. It's here to stay. So whatever you decide, you have to first assess properly your patient as far as the global risk is concerned, target organ damage, and then you start treatment and build on that. Thank you very much.